Okay, so today we'll talk about the skeletal system. Skeletal system consists of the skeleton. In the skeleton, you have bones and joints. You know that bones meet or unite at the joints. And you have cartilages in the skeleton. So those are the parts of the skeletal system. So first, we'll talk about the axial skeleton, which consists of the skull, thoracic case, and the vertebral column. So these three structures, the skull, the thoracic case, and the vertebral column, together form the axial or axial part of the skeleton. Another part of the skeleton is the appendicular part. This part consists of the bones of the upper and lower limbs. So upper and lower limb bones belong to the appendicular skeleton. So today we will talk about the axial skeleton. So first we will talk about the bones of the skull. In the skull we have two sets of bones: cranial bones and facial bones. So we will see what are the cranial and facial bones in the skull. Then we will talk about the bones of the thoracic case that protects the heart and other important organs there. And then we'll talk about the vertebral column, okay, bones of the vertebral column, and few abnormal or clinical conditions. First, in human skeleton, there are 206 bones, and in the axial part of the skeleton, you have total 80 bones. In the skull, you have the cranial and the facial bones. There are 8 cranial bones and 14 facial bones. Cranial bones join together to form a cavity called the cranial cavity, in which the most important organ, the brain, is located. Okay? So, protecting the brain is the main function of the cranial bones. Facial bones form the framework of the face. Also, you see here, the facial bones form the cavities for important sensory organs. For example, facial bones form the orbital fossa, these two, for the eye, right? Nasal cavity for the nose structures, oral cavity for the tongue. So those important sensory organs, your eyes, nose, tongue, those are located inside the cavities formed by the facial bones. Passages for the air and food. You know that through the nasal cavity, air gets in, through the oral cavity, food enters. into the body. Sites of attachment for teeth and muscles of facial expression. You also know that your teeth are attached to the facial bones. And there are several small muscles attached to the facial bones, and those muscles help in facial expressions. What are the facial expressions? When you get angry, the face changes, right? When you are sad, by looking at your face, someone can tell you are sad. So those are the happiness. Those are the expressions given by the muscles attached to the bones. So, what are the 8 cranial bones? 8 cranial bones are 1 frontal bone here, and behind the frontal bone you have 2 parietal bones here. They join at the sagittal suture midline. Then below the parietal bone you have the temporal bone around the ear here. So this is one temporal bone, this is another temporal bone. In the back you have the occipital bone, 1 occipital bone. So you got 6. What are the other 2? One is the sphenoid, it forms the floor of the skull, and ethmoid. Ethmoid is also in the bottom of the skull, but mostly it goes inside the nose. So those are 8 cranial bones. If you see the skull, front of the skull, you will be able to see some cranial and facial bones, not all of them. So here you see the yellow colored bone that forms the forehead part, mostly is the frontal bone. And behind the frontal bone you have 2 parietal bones shown by red color. You don't see other cranial bones except the small part, a small part of sphenoid and ethmoid. You can see those small parts of sphenoid and ethmoid through the orbital fossa. If you look through the orbital fossa, small part of the sphenoid and ethmoid can be seen, but most part is inside. In the front of the skull, you can see a number of facial bones. You can see the maxillary bones from the upper jaw. You see, this is the maxilla. This whole thing, upper jaw, is called the maxilla, formed by 2 maxillary bones. They join at the midline. Okay, so we have 2 maxillary bones from the maxilla, where the upper teeth are attached. Lower jaw is the mandible. Okay, this one. This is the largest, strongest and only movable bone of the skull. Okay, freely movable. You can move freely. You can move a lot. Then you have 2 zygomatic bones form the prominence of cheek. So the prominence of cheek is formed by the zygomatic bones. 2 nasal bones form the bridge of the nose. Behind the nasal bones you have lacrimal bones, small bones, and inside the nasal cavity you have homer. Homer is a plow shaped bone inside the nasal cavity from the partition, and inferior nasal conchae inside the nose. So homer and nasal conchae, those are inside the nose. So those are the facial bones. You can see the front of the skull. Sutures. Sutures are the joints where the cranial bones unite. So you see here these lines where the cranial bones unite are the sutures. Important sutures of your skull are coronal suture, sagittal suture, Lambert suture, and squamous suture. You need to know where these sutures are located and which bones are attached in these sutures. You must remember from your lab part, first lab, this plane is called the coronal plane, right, or frontal. So this suture, you see here, the suture going like this, this is the coronal suture, and it articulates the frontal and parietal, these two bones, okay, coronal suture, this way here. Then sagittal, you also know this is the sagittal plane, remember, sagittal plane. So the suture here is the sagittal suture that articulates two parietal bones. So two parietal bones meet at the sagittal suture. Then the Lambert suture articulates the parietal bones and occipital bone. So in the back, you know, this is the occipital bone and these two are parietal. So this suture is the Lambert suture. And then squamous suture is in the side of the skull, this one, articulates the temporal bone, this is the temporal bone around the ear, and this is the parietal bone. So this is the squamous suture. So those are the important sutures that hold the cranial bones strongly. The bottom of the skull, if you see the bottom of the skull, what is interesting here is you will find many holes. Some are small, some are big. Why you have many holes in the bottom of the skull? Because you know that blood vessels, right, they enter into the brain and cranial nerves get out from the brain, right, including the spinal cord. So for the passes of the blood vessels and cranial nerves, including the spinal cord, you have several holes. The large holes are usually called foramen and small holes are foramina. So you have many foramen. We'll see the important foramen. If you see here the sphenoid bone, that's the red colored one. As I mentioned before, sphenoid forms the floor of the skull, so you should be able to see the sphenoid here. The red colored bone here is the sphenoid, and it looks like a butterfly or flying bat. Have you seen bat? Flying bat? Okay. So that's the sphenoid. And in the sphenoid bone, you have foramen oval, oval shaped foramen. Then you have carotid canal in the temporal bone for the carotid artery, you know, common carotid artery. You have foramen spinosum, foramen lacerum. You have jugular foramen for the jugular vein. The largest foramen here is the foramen magnum. Magnum means big. Magnum. So foramen magnum is the largest one in the occipital bone. Okay, so that's the occipital bone. And spinal cord passes through the foramen magnum. Here in the bottom of the brain, you also see the hard palate. What is palate? Palate is the roof of the mouth. If you put your finger inside your mouth and move up, you will touch the palate. You can also use the tongue to touch the palate. So the hard palate is formed by two bones. Anterior two-third part is formed by the maxilla. Makes sense, because you see, this is the palate here, roof of the mouth. So this is the maxilla. So anterior two-third part is formed by the maxilla. Posterior one-third part is formed by the palatine bones. Very easy. Palatine bones form the palate. So anterior two-third by maxilla and posterior one-third by palatine bones. There are two palatine bones, they join together. So that is the hard palate. Hard palate. Okay. So those are the things you see in the bottom of the brain. Now we'll see a few cranial bones individually, and we'll try to see their parts. This is a temporal bone. You know, this is the temporal bone here. So if you see the temporal bone, the upper part or portion of the temporal bone is very simple, a flat bone, nothing else is there. Okay, so that part is called the squamous part. Lower part of the temporal bone has a number of structures. What are those structures? You see here, this piece of bone that is sticking out and going towards the zygomatic bone, you know, this is the zygomatic bone, cheek bone. This piece is called the zygomatic process of the temporal bone, because it is a part of the temporal bone going to the zygomatic bone. That's why it is called the zygomatic process of what? The temporal bone. There are two other processes here. One is this one. You see, kind of round plant. This one is called the mastoid process. You can feel it, the back of your ear lobe. That kind of round elevated part. That's the mastoid process. Sometimes pus, fluid, infected fluid accumulates inside this bone. If you have chronic ear infection, okay, and if you press ear, you will feel pain. By pressing, you can tell someone has ear infection. Okay, so that's the mastoid process. Another process, which is very pointed and sharp, you see this one. This is the styloid process. So these are three processes in the temporal bone: zygomatic process, mastoid process, and sharp pointed styloid process. You have a mandibular fossa here. Fossa is like, you know, sink like depression on the bone. So you have mandibular fossa here for what? For the mandible. You know that this is the mandible, and the mandibular condyle goes in mandibular fossa inside here to form the temporomandibular joint. Temporomandibular joint. at the mandibular fossa. Another thing you have is the external acoustic meatus, that is the outer ear canal. Okay, so those are the parts in the temporal bone. Sphenoid bone looks like a butterfly or flying bat. Why? Because it has a body in the middle and wings. It has four wings. That means two pairs. One pair is greater wing and another is lesser wing. Greater wings are bigger, lesser wings are smaller. So a body and four wings. Now you must remember when I showed you the bottom of the skull, I showed you the foramen oval in the sphenoid bone. So here you see the foramen oval or oval shaped foramen opening. Under the lesser wings you have optic canals. From the eye, you know your eye is here, from the eye optic nerve enters into the optic nerve enters into the brain through the optic canal. So you have two, because you have two eyes, two optic nerves go to the brain. Another important information is on the body. This is the body. On the body you have a fossa. Again, fossa is a depression, sink-like depression. So there is a fossa called the hypophyseal fossa. Why? For the pituitary gland. Pituitary gland sits there in that fossa. Another name of pituitary is hypophysis. You know, the master gland. Another name of pituitary is hypophysis. That's why that fossa is called the hypophyseal fossa, because the pituitary gland rests in it, sits in it. So, those are the parts of the sphenoid. Ethmoid bone. This bone is mostly inside the nasal cavity. That's why we don't see from outside. Only a small part you can see through the orbital fossa. This bone has two lateral masses and a middle portion. First, we'll see the middle portion. In the middle portion, you have two parts. So this is the middle portion and two lateral masses. Okay. In the middle portion, you have two parts. The part is going upwards. This is called crista galli. Crista galli. Crista galli. That is going upwards. Okay. Extending slightly upwards. And another part that is going, it's a flat bone going downwards, that is called the perpendicular plate. Perpendicular plate of ethmoid. Okay. So that's the middle portion. In lateral masses, you have many small air cavities. Cavities for air. Those are called air cells or sinuses. Okay. So that is the ethmoid. Now, this part the perpendicular plate of ethmoid and the vomer.
You remember I said vomer is inside the nose.
Vomer, this is vomer. These two bones together form the nasal septum, the partition inside the nose.
From above, the perpendicular plate of ethmoid comes, and from below, the vomer, and they join to form the hard part of the nasal septum.
Here you see the floor of the skull. If you look through inside, if you look from above, and what you can see here, the upper portion of the ethmoid in the front. In the front, you can see only the upper portion of ethmoid. That means what?
You see the crista galli, because this is the upper part. So you see the crista galli, and around the crista galli you have a thin plate of bone in which you have many tiny holes. Okay, so this is the crista galli, you can see, and a thin plate has many tiny holes. This thin plate is called cribriform plate. Cribriform plate of ethmoid, right?
And in the cribriform plate, these tiny holes are for the olfactory nerve fibers. You know, from the nose, you know, your ethmoid is mostly inside the nose. So from the nose, the olfactory nerve fibers that take the smell signal to the brain.
So these are called, that's why these holes are called olfactory foramina. You remember I said foramina means tiny holes, foramen is larger. So you have many tiny holes for the olfactory nerve fibers, that's why these are called olfactory foramen. Okay.
So that's the upper portion of ethmoid. Now you see here the sphenoid, the red color, and you see greater wings, lesser wings, foramen oval, optic canal. We have already talked about those things. On the body, you have the hypophyseal fossa for the pituitary gland, right? Remember that? So those are the things you can see. In the back part, you see the occipital bone, the largest foramen is the foramen magnum for the spinal cord to get out. Okay. Now we'll see the facial bones. There are how many facial bones? Anybody remember? 14. Very good. So what are the facial bones? One mandible. That's the only movable bone, freely movable bone. Two maxillary bones, you must remember I told you, they join to form the maxilla. Two zygomatic bones, two lacrimal bones, two nasal bones, two palatine bones from the palate, vomer one, and inferior nasal conchae. Vomer and nasal conchae are inside the nose. So those are 14 facial bones. First, mandible. If you see a mandible, it has a body and two arm-like parts. Those are called ramus. So, one body, this is the body here, and these two, doesn't want to stay there. So, this is the body and this is the arm-like part. Ramus. This is another ramus. Just see my arm here. So this is the body,
this is the
pramis. It's the body, pramis. Now, the lower teeth articulate with the mandible. And where the lower teeth articulates, this area is called the alveolar margin. Alveolar margin. In the body, there are two holes, one in each side. And you know, this area is called what? Which area is this? Anybody? Mentum. Okay. This is mental area. So these holes are called mental foramen. Very simple. If you know, this area is called the mental area, there is a mental foramen. Inside the ramus, if you see the inner surface of the ramus, you have mandibular foramen. You can see one in the inner surface of the ramus. So you have two mental foramen, two mandibular foramen. And as I have already mentioned, in the upper part of the ramus, you have the mandibular condyle in the back and another structure here in the front that is called the coronoid process. So this is the coronoid process. This is flat, pointed, and this is the round thick part that is the condyle. The condyle forms the temporomandibular joint here. Okay? And these two structures are separated by an U-shaped area. Always, if you see any U-shaped area in the bone, we say notch. So this is the mandibular notch. Okay? Temporomandibular joint is here, and one clinical condition very commonly heard is called the locked jaw. Have you heard that? Locked jaw, that happens in this joint. So just know those few things about this one. Maxillary bones. Two maxillary bones join to form the maxilla, which is the upper jaw. Upper teeth are attached to the maxilla. And maxilla is called the keystone bone. Why maxilla is called the keystone bone? Because you see here, your maxilla is sitting in the middle of the face, center of the face. And maxilla holds all the facial bones except the mandible. So all the facial bones are attached to the maxilla except the mandible. Mandible only gets attached to the temporal bone here at temporomandibular joint, you know that. But other facial bones are attached to the maxilla. So because of those two reasons, sitting centrally, middle, and holding the facial bones together, this bone is called the keystone. Where the teeth articulates again, this area is called the alveolar margin. So this is the alveolar margin of mandible. This is the alveolar margin of the maxilla. Now, this short, wide, extended part of the maxilla that is going to the zygomatic bone, you know this is the zygomatic bone. This piece is called the zygomatic process of what? Maxilla. Make sense? Part of maxilla going to the zygomatic bone. So zygomatic process of the maxilla. Another piece is going towards the frontal bone. That's why that is called the frontal process of the maxilla, going to the frontal bone. So you see here those two processes. Another thing about the maxillary bone is, inside the maxillary bone, you have the largest sinus. That means cavity filled with air.
So, largest sinus is the maxillary sinus. So, we have two maxillary sinuses.
Air filled cavities inside the bone. Okay.
Here you see the nasal bones, two nasal bones, tiny bones joined to form the bridge of the nose. And behind the nasal bone, you have that frontal process of maxilla. From the maxilla, the structure going towards the frontal bone. And then behind that, you have the lacrimal bone, small bone, in which you have a fossa. Again, fossa is a depression, right? In lacrimal bone, you have a fossa that is called the lacrimal fossa for the lacrimal sac. Lacrimal sac is a membranous sac, contains tear. Lacrimal fossa contains lacrimal sac, and it contains water. Okay.
You see here that green colored small bone. So that's the lacrimal bone. You must remember palatine bones form the posterior 1/3 part of the palate. I have mentioned anterior 2/3 is formed by the maxilla, right? So anterior 2/3 is formed by maxilla. Posterior 1/3 of hard palate is formed by the palatine bones. Homer is inside the nose that forms the lower part of the nasal septum. You remember I showed like this: upper part of nasal septum, lower part of nasal septum. Anybody? Let me draw here. Upper part is formed by what? Remember, perpendicular plate of ethmoid, right? That center part of the middle part of the ethmoid. Crista galli going upwards, perpendicular plate going downwards. Remember that? And from bottom, Homer. Those two come to form the nasal, hard part of nasal septum. So, Homer, I have already shown you on the board. Homer forms the lower part of the nasal septum. Here you see, your nose. Nasal septum has soft and hard part. How you know? You can move the nasal septum like this, right? You know, you can move nasal septum. That is the soft part. Cartilaginous part in the front. And in the back, you have the bony part. So, bony part is formed by those two bones. The perpendicular plate of ethmoid coming, that yellow color coming from above. And Homer coming from below. So, that's the nasal septum. Here you can also see the roof of the oral cavity, which is the palate, hard palate, formed by those two bones, anterior 2/3 maxilla, posterior 1/3 palatine bones. Paranasal sinuses. Around your nose, you have some sinuses. Sinuses are what? I just mentioned. Sinuses. What's the largest sinus is what? Which one?
Maxillary
sinus, right? Largest sinus is the maxillary sinus. And sinuses are what? Air-filled cavities inside the bone, right? Air-filled cavities inside the bone. Now, most of the sinuses are around the nose. That's why those are paranasal sinuses. Make sense? Important sinuses are frontal sinus, sphenoidal sinuses, ethmoid sinuses, and maxillary sinuses. Inside the frontal sphenoid, ethmoid and maxillary bones. Sinuses have few functions. One is, because of the sinuses inside the peroneal and facial bones, the weight of the skull is reduced. So the head part of the body gets lighter, enhancing the resonance of sound. And by doing that, it improves the quality of sound, speech. When we speak, the quality of sound that we produce is improved. So just remember those two. Here you see the location of the sinuses around the nose. As I have mentioned, largest ones are maxillary sinuses. Inflammation of the mucous membrane, there is mucous membrane inside the sinus, is called sinusitis. Sinusitis. Have you heard that? Sinusitis? Yes or no? Okay. Sinusitis. Very commonly heard, right? Very often we hear that term. Itis is the inflammation of sinus, sinusitis. Okay? You know, other inflammation we say conjunctivitis, meningitis, tonsillitis, pharyngitis, nephritis, hepatitis, depending on which organ, right? Gastritis. So, sinusitis is the inflammation of the sinus. Sometimes, what happens, fluid accumulates in sinusitis. Fluid, normally air is there, right? But in sinusitis, fluid accumulates and infection, the microorganisms can quickly grow in that fluid, because that is body fluid, and cause the problems in sinusitis. Okay? You will feel headache, heaviness of the face or head, and might have temperature, body temperature increase. In that case, what you can do, if antibiotic doesn't take care of that, then you have to drain the fluid, take the fluid out, and then give treatment, antibiotic or other medicines. Hyoid bone. This is the hyoid bone in the front of the neck. This bone is called a lonely bone. Lonely. Why? It doesn't have any friend. That's why it is lonely, right? Why it doesn't have any friend? Nobody wants to take him with them. Got it? When we talk about the bones of the skull, we don't include it, right? When we talk about the bones of the vertebral column, we don't include it. When we talk about the bones of the thoracic case, we don't include it. So he is very lonely, right? So this is the lonely bone of your body. And it is not directly attached to any bone. Now the question is then how it is staying there if it is not attached. It is hung by the ligaments. So ligaments hold this bone here. It is not directly attached to any bone. Make sense? Ligaments hold it. Although this is a lonely bone, it has important functions. You know that anterior neck muscles are here, and most of the anterior neck muscles get support from this bone, because this is the only bone in the front of the neck. So most of the anterior neck muscles get attached to it and get support from this hyoid bone. So important, because you know that anterior neck muscles help in swallowing, right, of food. So, important bone. you have a body and four horns, horn-like structures, two greater horns, two lesser horns. So similar to sphenoid, a body, in a sphenoid you had four what? Wings, right? Remember, two greater wings, two lesser. Here you have a body and four horns, greater horns, lesser horns. Okay, now we'll see the vertebral column, also called the spine. Vertebral column has, you see here, many vertebrae, and then you have a large triangular bone here that is called the sacrum, and below the sacrum you have tiny bones like tail. Those are called the coxes. So many vertebrae, one sacrum and few coxes together form the vertebral column. Okay. Now, vertebrae are divided into three groups or types. In the neck part, you see here, these are thoracic vertebrae. How many? Seven. In the thoracic part, you have thoracic vertebrae, 12. And in the lumbar area, you have, you know, this is the lumbar area, you have five lumbar vertebrae. So those are vertebrae. Seven cervical, 12 thoracic, five lumbar. Then you have one sacrum. And coxes, the number is not fixed. Sometimes they join together. So we can say 2 to 4 in number. Those are very tiny bones. Now, vertebral column or spine keeps the body straight, right? Keeps the body straight. And another important function is it transmits the weight from the upper part of the body to the lower part. So, from the upper part of the body weight is transmitted through the vertebral column. Okay, number two. Number three, another very important function, your spinal cord is protected by the vertebral column, because we know that spinal cord is located inside the vertebral column. So those three are very important functions. Intervertebral discs are the plates. You see, these are the intervertebral discs where the body of the vertebrae get attached to each other. So intervertebral disc. And they provide cushioning. And absorbs the shock. You know that body weight is transmitted, so shock absorber. Now, if you see an intervertebral disc, it has a center portion and the outer part. Center part is soft, jelly-like soft structure. And it is called nucleus pulposus. We know that nucleus indicates the center, right? Usually. So, nucleus pulposus, a soft jelly-like structure. And around the nucleus pulposus, this structure is like a ring. And that's why it is called annular fibrosis. Annular means ring shaped. Okay? So annular. Why fibrosis? Because you have many fibers in it, and it is a fibrocartilage. Since this cartilage has many fibers, it is a fibrocartilage.
you know fibrocartilage already. You have seen under the microscope many fibers, right? So this part is very tough because it has lot of fibers. Any structure in your body has a lot of fibers, that is tough. Make sense? Fibers make the structure strong, tough. Slipped disc or herniated disc is a clinical condition. Sometimes what can happen, the intervertebral disc can slip or can move away from its normal position. Make sense? Can move away. And the word hernia, have you heard hernia? I believe all of you have heard. What is hernia? Hernia indicates the disposition or dislocation. Any structure of your body, if it moves from its normal position to abnormal position, that is called what? Hernia. Make sense? So if your intestine moves away, that is herniated intestine. Make sense? If your inguinal canal, you know, gets ripped and moves away, the structures move away from the inguinal canal, that is called inguinal hernia. You see, this is the inguinal canal and this is the spermatic cord in male. If it gets out, that is inguinal hernia. So if the structure or organ or part of it moves from normal to abnormal position, that is called hernia. This is herniated disc because the disc has moved away from its normal location. And you see in the left side here, the part of the disc has moved backwards. Now, what is the problem? Problem is, you see here, these are called intervertebral foramen. And through the intervertebral foramen, spinal nerves get out from the spinal cord. So these are spinal nerves. Okay. So what happens if this disc, you see here, this is the disc, right? If it moves backwards, then it presses on the spinal nerve. Make sense? You press the spinal nerve and you feel severe pain because the spinal nerve supplies to the muscles. So that is the herniated or slipped disc. Parts of a typical vertebrae. A typical vertebrae has a body and seven processes. How many processes? Seven. Body is this one. And what are the seven processes? You see, one process that goes backwards, that is the spinous process going backwards. Two processes go laterally, sideways, like this. Those are called the transverse processes. Make sense? Transverse process. And then there are two processes go upwards, like here, upwards. Those are called superior, above, superior articular processes. And two processes downwards, those are inferior articular processes. Make sense? So one going backwards, that is what? Everybody? Spinous process, right? Two going sideways, laterally, those are transverse processes, right? Two going upwards, those are superior articular processes. Articular means what? Articulation means what? Have you heard the term articulation? Joint, right? Joining. Which articulate the sentence. Joint, right? Make. So, articulation is joint. So, two superior articular processes and two what? Inferior articular processes.
Why those are called articular processes? Because they articulate. How? This is superior, inferior articular process, right? And this is superior articular process of the vertebrae below. They join like this. So this side, this is another, right? So you have two pairs. So they hold the vertebrae together. Superior from the vertebrae above, inferior from the vertebrae above and superior from the vertebrae below. They get attached like this, okay? Here you see two articular processes. Okay, so those are seven processes. Now, other two structures you need to know. You see the spinous process and transverse process are attached by the part of the bone or vertebrae that is called lamina. So you have two lamina, spinous process and the transverse process are attached by lamina. And the body is attached to the rest part by pedicle. So you have two pedicles. You see, body is attached to the rest part by the pedicle. And inside the vertebrae, you have a nice foramen opening that is called the vertebral foramen. Inside the vertebrae, the foramen, vertebral foramen. That contains what? Which structure passes through that? Spinal cord, right? We know that the spinal cord is inside the vertebral column. So, now, if I show you a single vertebrae and show you that foramen, that is called the vertebral foramen. Now, if I put more, then what will happen? It will form a canal called the vertebral canal, except in which the spinal cord is located or passes through. So, those are the parts of a typical vertebrae. Now, why is it typical? Because we have atypical too, not usual. Unusual is atypical. First and second cervical vertebrae, those are called atypical vertebrae. They look different than all other vertebrae. Make sense? So all other vertebrae are typical. First and second, those are atypical vertebrae. Okay, now we know that there are seven cervical vertebrae. Among those, lower five look similar. Exception is upper two, first and second. First we'll see the typical one of those five. If you see a cervical vertebrae, how you can identify it? Very simple, very easy. You see, in cervical vertebrae, the end of the spinous process, you know the spinous process, the end of the spinous process is split, bifided, or divided. You can see here. See, look carefully. The end of the spinous process is bifided. Another thing is, in the transverse process, you have transverse foramen. So, you have transverse foramen in the transverse process. So, if you see those two things, definitely it is a cervical vertebrae. Because in thoracic or lumbar, you don't have those things. Make sense? So, easy. Then, we know that C1 and C2, that means cervical 1 and 2, those are atypical, right? Those are not similar to others. Those are different, unusual. How? In C1, cervical 1, you don't have any body, no body. So this is the only vertebrae which doesn't have a body. And no spinous process. It has two arches, like St. Louis arch, you know, like this. So this vertebra is like this, two arches. One is this one, another arch is here. Okay? So two arches, no body, no spinous process. If you see that, that is a C1 or atlas. C1 is called the atlas because on C1 the skull, which is like a globe, sits. Okay, so on the C1 we know that this globe sits. So this is called an atlas. You see here, no body, two arches, okay, no spinous process. C2 is called the axis. Why? It is called axis because on C2 there is a structure like this, finger-like structure going upwards, that is called dens. And this is C1. So C1 is like a ring, right? You know that no body is there. So this is C2. C1 gets attached to C2 like this. This dens go here. And C1 rotates like this, around this. Make sense? So that's why this is called axis. Around this axis, C1 moves like this. Okay. So, you see, from the body of C2, the finger-like structure projected upwards, that is called the dens, and that forms the axis. So, this bone is the C2. Another thing, just it's not in the slide, you need to know. This is the thoracic case. And in each side of the thoracic case, you have 12 ribs. How many? 12. Okay. And the ribs, most of those ribs are attached to the bone in the center of the thoracic case, that is called the sternum. So this is the sternum. These are ribs. Most of the ribs get attached to the sternum by costal cartilages. These are called costal cartilages. So now those ribs are attached to the sternum by the costal cartilages. Those are non-floating ribs. Last two ribs are not attached to the sternum. No costal cartilage is attached. These are called the floating ribs. Make sense? Floating. So, non-floating and floating ribs. Another thing we do, we divide those 12 ribs into two groups, true and false. Upper 7 are called true ribs. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. These 7 are called true ribs, and lower 5 are called false ribs. True ribs, each true rib gets a costal cartilage individually. Upper 3 false ribs get attached by one costal cartilage here, and lower 2 are floating. So now 12, top 7 are true, bottom 5 are false. Among these 5 false, upper 3 are non-floating, lower 2 are floating. Okay, so we can do this way. Ribs in each side, upper 7 are true ribs, and lower 5 are what? False.
among lower five falls, upper three are non-floating, and lower two are floating. So that's how we group the reefs. Okay, so just now that information. Some abnormal conditions in relation to the vertebral column, related to the vertebral column. Scoliosis, kyphosis, lordosis, those three are abnormal bend of the spine. Scoliosis is if the spine or vertebral column is bent this way, sideways, that is called scoliosis. So the person will look like this, right? Will look like this, sideways bending. Kyphosis usually happens in the upper part of the vertebral column, here in the thoracic part. What happens in kyphosis? This part of the spine gets curved like this, so the person's upper part of the body will look like this. Okay, so that is kyphosis, bent forward, the upper portion. And lordosis occurs in the lower part of the vertebral column, not in the upper part. Kyphosis occurs here, lordosis usually occurs here. If something pushes from the back in this part, then the person's body will go like this, right? So that is the lordosis. So those are due to abnormal curve in the vertebral column. Do you remember the movie? I believe many of you have watched that when you were small. Quasimodo, the Hunchback of Notre Dame. That Quasimodo had what? Kyphosis, right? Kyphosis. So remember that. Easy to remember. Quasimodo had kyphosis. So you know what is kyphosis. Okay. Spina bifida. It is telling you, the name is telling you. You remember spinous process in the back of the vertebra? Spinous process, right? Bifid, I have mentioned. Bifid means split, right? So, what happens in this clinical condition? The spinous process remains split, divided, and a space remains open in between those two. So the spinal cord or the covering of the spinal cord, which is called the meninges, either the meninges can come out or the spinal cord with the covering can come out. Okay, so that is spina bifida. And if only the covering meninges comes out, that is not that dangerous, right? But if the spinal cord also comes out through that space, then that could be dangerous. That can cause paralysis in the lower part of the body and other complications. So here we see two conditions. The right one is called meningocele, in which only the covering came out through the space. And in the left side, which is called meningomyelosis, in which spinal cord has come out. Okay? Meningomyelosis. So those are two things that can happen in spina bifida. Need the surgical procedure to fix that. Make sense? Okay. All those are developmental disorder, usually get due to abnormality in
the growth or development.